Welcome aboard the Evolution Eisenbahn, the train of life, where we go on guided tours through the tree of life to learn about biology and evolution. I am Sebastian and I am your tour guide. Today we will travel to the Archaea. They are a whole new domain of life and surely the most overlooked and underappreciated. Let's see if I can change your opinion on them. Or if you don't have an opinion on them yet, let me give you one. A good one. Off we go. We have just left Luca Station, and the Archaea are only one stop away, so we will be there very soon. And by the way, Archaea means the old ones, and the name is very fitting. They're about as old as it gets. On the last tour, I said that the bacteria might be the oldest group of living beings, but that might not be true. It could also be the Archaea. It's really hard to know. They and the bacteria appeared about 3.8 billion years ago. Whereas the third domain, the eukaryotes, appeared much, much later, about 2 billion years later. So yeah, the Archaea are ancient.
Next stop, Archaea.
And there, we already arrived. 3.8 billion years really fly by if you're having fun, right? Welcome to modern day Archaea. Now, if you're not already familiar with them, you're probably asking yourself, what exactly are Archaea? And well, as I said, they are their own whole domain of life, but that is a relatively recent classification. Before 1977, they were just considered to be weird bacteria, and it wasn't until 1990 that they were given their own domain. In our defense, they look exactly like bacteria. At least most of them. There's also some unique shapes, like this one that is square-shaped, but most of them look like regular bacteria. And it wasn't until modern molecular biology that we figured out how different they are. So, for example, their whole cellular machinery is different. They have some elements that are like in bacteria, and some elements that are like in eukaryotes, and then some elements are really unique and are only found in the Archaea. For example, their membranes are fundamentally built differently than in all other life forms. They really do their own thing. And in some Archaea, the membrane lipids are even fused together, so they technically have a monolayer membrane, which is astounding because all other membranes that we've ever seen are bilayer. All right, now you might say, that's all well and good, but I still don't really understand what Archaea are. Well, I have to admit, on the surface, they are very similar to bacteria, right? However, the first ones we discovered were extreme. They loved the extremes. We could call them extremophiles. We found them where nothing else could survive, in boiling water, in strong acid, or in extremely salty water. And that's the reason we found them at all, because there was just nothing else alive in these conditions, so they stood out. And once we knew to look, we found more and more, and always in these extreme environments. There are hyperthermophiles that thrive at 120 degrees Celsius. Water only goes up to 100 degrees, so you can't even reach that without using a pressure cooker, or, you know, by being deep in the ocean. And there are salt-resistant halophiles, which live in water that's more than 30% salt. That's 10 times saltier than seawater. Any other cell would shrivel up. And there are acidophiles, which can live in strong acid, down to a pH value of minus 0.6. If you know anything about the pH scale, you realize how crazy acidic that is. That scale isn't even supposed to go below zero, and yet the acidophiles live there. So one thing is clear, the Archaea seem to like the extremes. And that informed how we saw them. Did they maybe retain these traits from the early days of life? You know, when life formed in some hot, acidic, primordial soup at an underwater hydrothermal vent. Maybe the Archaea just failed to adapt to less extreme environments, and that's the reason that they are outcompeted everywhere else by bacteria and eukaryotes. Seems like the old Archaea didn't stand a chance against more sophisticated life forms. The only thing that saved them was that they were less picky about where to live. Kinda like cars have displaced horses almost everywhere, except maybe where the terrain is too rough to build streets. There, horses still have their uses, just like Archaea can still make a living where, you know, it's too uncomfortable for more modern bacteria and eukaryotes. That was our image of Archaea, and that's how I used to think about them too. And this view is completely and utterly false. When we finally started to do sequencing, that is when we analyzed DNA in environmental samples, we found Archaea genes everywhere, like literally everywhere. We found Archaea everywhere in the ocean, everywhere on land, in the soil, on plants and on animals, and on you and in you. There are Archaea on your skin right now, and in your gut, and in your mouth. Can you taste them? They were there the whole time, hiding in plain sight. And they are abundant too. We now estimate that they make up at least 20% of all microbial cells in the entire ocean. And in the seafloor, there are way more archaea than bacteria. And we found dozens of species living in and on humans, with more being described all the time. And you have probably heard that animals produce methane, right? There's a lot of discussion, for example, about methane-rich cow burps and their contribution to climate change, because methane is a strong greenhouse gas. But did you also know that archaea are actually the only organisms on this planet that can produce methane? That's right, all the methane in the cow burps and also in your own farts is produced by archaea in the gut. No bacterium can do it. It's all them. Oh, and did you know that the fastest living being on this planet is an archaeon too? If you measure speed by body length per second, which is a fair way to compare speeds, the archaea take the gold medal, and it's not even close. The archaeon M. genetiae is way faster than, for example, the fastest bacteria or animals or fighter jets. So how was that? Archaea are supposed to be primitive life forms outcompeted by bacteria and eukaryotes? As if anything, they are more successful than the other two domains, right? Because they can live everywhere they can, plus they can live in these extreme environments. They are not horses, they are flying cars, and somehow we never looked up and saw them. Okay, but how could this happen? How come we didn't find them sooner? Well, there are actually several reasons. For one, they're pretty freaking small. Now you say, well, that's also true for bacteria, and yet we seem to have no trouble finding those everywhere. And that's true, but there's a very good reason why we had no trouble discovering bacteria everywhere. Because they interact with us in really tangible ways. You don't need a microscope or DNA sequencing to find them. Many of them are pathogens and cause specific diseases in humans and also in animals and plants we care about. And we also eat many of them, like they make yogurt and cheese and sourdough. So yeah, we have a common history with the bacteria that's as old as humanity. But archaea? Even to this day, there is not a single disease that we have found that's caused by archaea. Not a single one, which is really remarkable and surprising actually. And there's also no such thing as archaea cheese. So my point is, the only way to find them was with a microscope. And every time we looked, we thought we were seeing bacteria. And now that we actually know their genetic signatures, now that we know what to look for, we find them everywhere. And I think we have just now begun to realize what they truly are. Like, it seems we now know a lot about them, but I suspect that that iceberg below the water surface is truly gargantuan. All right, let me end with a story how in the archaea we might have found our gods, in a way. So it happened pretty recently, in 2015, that researchers were collecting samples in the Arctic Sea at an underwater hydrothermal vent they called Loki's castle. Loki, as in the god of mischief and trickery in Norse mythology. Apparently they named it that because it was so tricky to find. And of course, they found new archaea there. And because these new archaea were so different from all the others we had found, they classified them as a new phylum, a new supergroup of archaea. And they named this new phylum LOKIARCHAEOTA, because nerds are just delightful like that. And of course, when they found other archaea elsewhere on the planet that were similar to the LOKIARCHAEOTA, they called them ODINARCHAEOTA, THORARCHAEOTA, HEIMDALLARCHAEOTA, and so on. Because nerds are delightful like that. All these guys have now been officially gathered under the superphylum called ASGARD, by the way. ASGARD as in the home of the gods in Norse mythology. So delightful. But now comes the kicker. These Asgard archaea show some eukaryote traits. For example, they can change their shape. That's something no bacterium can do. And indeed, genetic analyses show that the eukaryotes seem to be most closely related to Asgard archaea specifically. It's still early, but do you realize what this means if it is true? Eukaryotes don't just have a common ancestor with archaea, they are archaea. We are archaea. All eukaryotes, and that includes all multicellular life forms, are the descendants of Asgardian gods. Well, in part at least. The eukaryote is actually the combination of an Asgard archaeon and a proteobacterium. So in a way, you could say that the archaea are our great-great-great-great-grandma and the bacteria are our great-great-great-great-grandpa, or something like that. I will tell you the whole story on a future tour when we explore the rest of the tree of life, which is all eukaryotes after all. But with that, today's archaea tour comes to a close. Did I change your opinion on the archaea? Or maybe do you now have an opinion on archaea for the first time? As the case may be, I hope you enjoyed the tour and you'll join me in trying to give archaea the respect and the recognition that they deserve. Join us next time on another tour on the train of life. Thank you for choosing Evolution Eisenbahn. Take care and goodbye.